Good afternoon. I'm Dr. Gregory Gaydos, and welcome to another session of Global Connections. Tonight, I'm hosting this discussion with a distinguished professor from Hawaii Pacific University, Pierre Asselin, who is a graduate, a doctorate of from the University of Hawaii, as am I. His was in history, mine is in political science. In fact, this particular session on global connections is a continuation of a sort of something that I and Dr. King did, and which Christine Hansen did, in which we're looking at Dr. King and I call the collapse of industrial civilization, threats to our society. And we identified many. Dr. King especially talked about overpopulation, resource depletion, peak oil, weather changes that are coming about from climate change, and many other things. I brought up the electromagnetic pulse that hits us every 140 years from the sun, and we're due for one, which would fry the electronic grid. And if it were to happen, according to Ted Koppel, who wrote a book called Lights Out, if they did fry the grid, which is, by the way, considered the greatest accomplishment in human history, the North American grid, encompassing Canada and the United States, 90% of us would die within a year, simply because we need that to move food, and et cetera, things like that. Nothing's going to work, no electricity, no elevators. Those living in high rises had better camp out there at the park with the homeless, because there's no going up and down 40 stairs with your water every day and trying to flush your toilet. At any rate, 2 weeks ago, Christine and I looked at infectious diseases in an age of globalization, because we're in a very dangerous situation where diseases are in danger of getting out of control, such as MERS and SARS, and there's superbugs that are now resistant to the penicillin, etc., etc. And we looked at how close we're coming to maybe running into an epidemic or a pandemic, sort of like what happened after World War I when the flu devastated, I mean, more people died in that flu than died in World War I. It was really quite devastating. But now we're into today looking at something called immigration in the age of globalization. Suddenly people are transferring across borders in a way that we didn't really anticipate earlier. When we said globalization, we meant that goods would cross borders. We meant that ideas would cross borders. We meant that money could cross borders, and that would make us all richer and more self-sufficient. It didn't encompass people, but now people are going carrying those diseases, which is bad enough, but now we're worrying about, are they carrying ideas that could bring about the collapse of civilization? And so Dr. Asselin is an expert in everything historical, so he might have some ideas here about to what extent we can continue to allow people to migrate because they want to. There is among the liberals among us this idea that anybody can go anywhere. And others who are on the conservative side say, oh, no, a nation is an organic entity that has a set of values, and you can go into that country providing you endorse those values and be a part of it. So let me ask now, Pierre, how serious a threat do you think people crossing the borders, our southern border or other borders, is a threat to America if they don't assimilate into our society?
I don't think it's a threat at all. I think that the fear we have of outsiders is certainly understandable, but in terms of it actually constituting a threat relative to other threats that we face, including some of the things you've mentioned, like environmental degradation, we're creating here an issue that really shouldn't be. And looking at history, right? So now there's this fear that Muslims will do this, this, and that. Go back 100 years or so, mid-19th century, we have more or less the same fears about the American Republic being compromised, but this time it involves Catholics. You know, as I'm assuming you know, right, that there was this a rabid fear of Catholicism in the United States during the mid-19th century, right? We have this the so-called Know-Nothing Party, right, that the Native American Party that effectively calls for a ban on Catholic immigration. We burn churches down to the ground. We beat up, we even kill Catholics. So you know, and looking back, well, it maybe was an overreaction. And I can't help but think that in 50 and 100 years from now, we're going to probably feel the same way about how some people in this country feel about the threat coming from Muslims. And speaking of Catholics, I want to point this out because it's so interesting. Things got so bad for Catholics that during the Mexican-American War, a bunch of American Catholics actually formed a battalion to go and fight on the side of Mexico against the United States. So you know,
Protestants were right then. They're a danger.
You know, so you know, it's we create these fears. We're not comfortable with what we're not familiar with, and eventually in time we realize that oh, maybe we exaggerated the threat. And I think that looking back, eventually we'll feel the same way about this so-called threat caused by outsiders or Muslims specifically these days.
Well, I'd like to push back a little bit here. I think that everything you said is true, by the way, about the Know-Nothings and Catholics and so forth and the Asian Exclusion Act and so on. So we've always been a little worried about these people coming in, and always they've successfully integrated because we've always had a policy of assimilation. And there's a public school, and we took people from around the world and we put them through the meat grinder of the public school, and they came out Americans, no matter what they went in. They're not like their parents that came here. The parents might have had babushkas, but they don't wear babushkas anymore, so on and so forth. So that has worked very well. Unfortunately, now there's a new disease out there called multiculturalism. Which is replacing Americanism here. And the tenets of this are such that you can go to another country and you take your culture with you and you just practice it there. You're not assimilating anymore. You're going to live in your little ghettos. And this is happening all over Europe. It's happening in America, where people are doing, not as much in America, we still assimilate to some extent, but to a great extent, especially across our southern border, there are people flooding in where they don't want to give up their language, for example. And always you had to give up your language, in other words, to be part of America. So I would think that we have to look at this as a little bit different. It's wrong, I think, to call Islam, which is the primary threat, a religion like Buddhism, Hinduism, Christianity, and so forth. We're committing fallacy of the logical types that Bertrand Russell talked about. When he wrote Principia Mathematica in 1908, he developed his theory of logical types in the introduction. And in this theory, he said that you must never treat something of a different order on the same level. You shouldn't say, oh, I like apples, oranges, grapes, and fruit, because you committed an error, because fruit is another higher logical type than these others. I think we're doing the same thing with Islam. Islam is not a religion, per se. It's partly a religion, but if you really take the Quran seriously, it's really an ideology. It's something of a higher level. It's a total worldview. And if you let people in who have this devotion to this higher worldview, and not to their religion. Now, Catholics still admire the Pope, but they're not going to follow the Pope rather than follow Trump, I don't think. But a real serious Muslim has a commitment to Islam, not to America. They don't believe in nations, they believe in Islam, and that should conquer the world. That's part of their credo, written in the Quran. Now, here's the problem. Most of us have Muslim friends, I suppose you do, I do, but they're bad Muslims. Meaning, they don't read the Quran. They don't say, oh, I'm not supposed to be friends with the Jews and the Christians.
I think that's the question. So what's a good Muslim? What's a bad Muslim? Mm-hmm. What's a good Catholic? What's a bad Catholic? Mm-hmm. You know, so I'm French-Canadian. I was born Catholic. I go to church once a year at Christmas.
Me too.
I wouldn't call myself a bad Catholic, although in the eyes of radicals,
true.
I certainly would be. So I think, you know, we have a tendency here sometimes to focus on the extremists and see these individuals as a reflection of something larger. Mm-hmm. And I think that's definitely the problem with Islam. Most Muslims I know here that I've encountered in my travels to the Islamic world kind of feel about their religion in a number of ways the way I kind of feel about Catholicism. Mm-hmm. You know, it's part of your identity because you're born into it. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And you take it seriously to the extent that current circumstances warrant. Mm-hmm. So I don't know, you know, I see your point, and certainly there are individuals who kind of fit the description that you've provided, but I think applying that to Muslims generally and to Islam specifically, I'm not sure I would agree with you on that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well you're taking a modern attitude here, and it is true that Islam has.
I would call it sensible, but I'll go with modern.
Islam has been quiescent for the last, since they were defeated in 1689, I guess, at the gates of Vienna when the King of Poland saw them off. Was it Suleiman the Magnificent?
Yeah, Suleiman the Magnificent,
Sent him back to Turkey there.
Yeah.
That was their second jihad, the first jihad going up through North Africa,
Iberia,
Spain,
and
meeting Charles Martel at Tours, where he turned them back there. Okay, so they went into decline, and they've been quiet for 300 years. And so we're used to thinking of Muslims as just being nice, humble people going to the mosque and praying and being nice people. And to the extent that they were that, no one would have any objection because we would tolerate that. That's what America would stand for, that kind of freedom. Only if it would compete with Americanism, if it would compete with our freedoms, democracy, and so forth. Do you have a loyalty above that to Allah and think, no, my duty here is to take the world into Muslims? Now, I know, again, going to the Muslims you know and I know, I mean, I have a friend who actually is from Iran, and he went back to Iran after he graduated from UH, and then he got trapped by the revolution in 79, and then he couldn't get out, but he finally got out because his sister got sick, and she has to be escorted if one goes anywhere, so he took her to England, and then when she was fixed up, she went back on her own, and he went to Canada, in fact, where he is now. But he told me that when he was there, he doesn't really follow Ramadan and things like that, and so you're not supposed to eat or drink during the day, right?
Yeah.
And so he was there, and he was making some coffee, which you're not supposed to do. And then the coffee pot exploded, and then the woman next door heard that, and she calls up the Revolutionary Guard. We have a counter-revolutionary planting bombs or something. So they came in and looked around, and what happened? And then they saw it was just the coffee. And they said, you old middling woman, you're calling us for this nonsense here. And they didn't even chew him out for that, even though he was violating it. And they just sort of laughed at it and passed him by. So he's the kind of good guy that we would want to have. And there are other good Muslims. Zudi Jara? I think the guy who is the head of the Islamic reform movement, he wants to take Islam and reform it so that Muslims read the Quran, and all these passages are there. There are nice passages at the beginning. Towards the end, they get more and more militant. But he wants them not to see their duty to go out and kill people if they don't accept Islam. And not part of the Quran says never make friends with Christians and Jews unless you want to pretend for a while, but it can't be sincere. Well, that kind of thing we wouldn't want to have happen. So that's the fear, that the people who take it really seriously, read the Quran literally and say, oh, we've got to go out and do jihad.
But so here's the thing, right? As it turns out, most Muslims can't read the Quran, right? I mean, technically, as a
praise be the Allah.
Right? So you know, growing up in Quebec, my father couldn't read the Bible because it was only in Latin, right?
Yes,
so you trust the padre.
Right.
And that's the problem with organized religion, and in this case, Catholicism in Quebec, you know, 30 years ago, and Islam today, is that so the devout Muslim technically cannot read the Quran in languages other than Arabic. Mm-hmm. So unless you know Arabic, you can't read the Quran. Mm-hmm. And Arabs are actually a minority within the Islamic world. So,
right.
so people who are literate and Arab can actually read the Quran. Mm-hmm. Everyone else mm-hmm. can't unless they study Arabic, mm-hmm. which happens to be one of the most difficult languages to learn, mm-hmm. right? So that's a very problematic element, and I think mm-hmm. it makes some people susceptible to the interpretations of hardline elements, mm-hmm. right? To the interpretations of imams and scholars and basically like Muslim padres. Mm-hmm. So there's that element. But so, you know, the idea that reading the Quran will create these views is problematic because, again, the majority of Muslims will never be able to read the Quran. That's mm-hmm. why people memorize mm-hmm. verses from the Quran, right? Mm-hmm. the one thing I do want to point out, Greg, is, you know, when you talk about Muslims, right? Mm-hmm. In my experience, Muslims never assert that as their primary identity. Mm-hmm. You know, I think just like, you know, I mean, as I was saying, I'm Catholic, but I don't want people to think of me as Catholic. I want them to well, I'm Quebecois above all, and mm-hmm. and you know, I like ice hockey, and mm-hmm. and then, you know, my religion is. And to me, most Muslims, perhaps if we talk about religion, we'll identify as Muslims, but beyond that, people who happen to be Muslim will more often than not identify as Algerian, mm-hmm. identify as Libyan. Mm-hmm. And then beyond that, they'll identify as a member from that clan, from mm-hmm. that family mm-hmm. in southern Libya. Mm-hmm. You know, I know that in recent trips in Algeria, trying to have these discussions about what it means to be Algerian was fascinating mm-hmm. because you take for granted that, okay, we are Muslim, so that doesn't even come into the conversation about identity. It's all mm-hmm. about are you Arab, are you what they call Kabyle or Berber, mm-hmm. and then if you're Kabyle, what part of mm-hmm. Algeria? So mm-hmm. all of these things condition identity, and I think, again, it's overly simplistic of mm-hmm. us.
Thanks for watching ThinkTech Hawaii, and look forward to seeing you at Education Matters on Tuesdays with me, Carol Monley.
Hi, I'm Tim Apicella. I'm the host of Moving Hawaii Forward, a show dedicated to transportation issues and traffic issues here on Oahu. Join us every other Tuesday at 12 noon, and as we discuss how we try to solve our traffic headaches, not to include just rail, but transit and carpooling and everything in between. So join us every other Tuesday, Moving Hawaii Forward. Thank you.
Aloha kakou. I'm Marcia Joyner, and I'm inviting you to navigate the journey. We are discussing the end of life options, and we would really love to have you every Wednesday morning at 11 a.m. right here.
We're back here with Pierre Asselin, our distinguished professor of history at Hawaii Pacific University, and he's giving us a good tutoring here on Islam and why we need not fear it as we let people in. Of course, just yesterday we had this guy who from England, I forget his name, who killed a policeman, ran some people down. I guess the car is the latest weapon of Islam. Yeah. They give enough for the sword for the car. And so are Muslims migrating to a society, a free society, a danger or not? And you're pointing out, I think correctly, that they do have a lot of identity with nations, even though they're not supposed to. If you read the Quran, you're supposed to only be loyal to Islam. You're not even supposed to have nations. And so Bernard Lewis said that true Islamists think that it's nations, there's a world of Islam and nations within it, whereas most people think that there are nations in which they practice religions like Christianity and Judaism and so forth. So the jihadists who are motivated by what they learn at the mosques and so forth, coming under the radical preachers that are sent out from Saudi Arabia, because Saudi Arabia has this most extreme version of that, they get radicalized by them or on the internet from the Anwar al-Sadat presentations that he made calling on them to have jihad. So there's going to, I think, going to be a continual supply of these people. The what is it, Sadiq Khan, who's now the mayor of England.
London, yeah. This is London.
This is a liberal attempt. Well, for nice to make a Muslim a mayor, maybe they'll be nice to us. But they don't say, oh, how nice they are. Let's be a British. They say, ah, Allah is the hand of God. He made Sadiq Khan the mayor to pave our way to taking over. So they see that as their avenue to the to taking over the societies. And those Muslims who meet in the park and scream and say, go home, you know, we're taking over the society and so forth. There is that element there. We really don't want that element there, do we? If you have a loyalty to something else that's hostile to your country, you shouldn't be in that country. If you want to be in that country, you should acclimate. I have here something that I always teach my classes from Aristotle's Politics here. And he talks about the reasons where we have revolution. And he gives 17 causes, the primary one being economic inequality. But one of the reasons, he says, another cause of revolution is differences of races which do not at once acquire a common spirit. For a state is not the growth of a day any more than it grows out of a multitude brought together by accident. Hence, the reception of strangers in colonies, either at the time of their foundation or afterwards, has generally produced revolution. For example, the Achaeans, who joined the Troezenians in the foundation of Sybaris, becoming later the more numerous, expelled Sybarites. Hence, the curse fell upon Sybaris. At Thurii, the Sybarites quarreled with the fellow colonists, thinking that the land belonged to them. They wanted too much of it and were driven out. At Byzantium, the new colonists were detected in a conspiracy and were expelled by force of arms. The people of Antissa, who had received the Chian exiles, fought with them and drove them out. And the Zancleans, after having received the Samians, were driven out by them out of their own city. The citizens of Poliano at Zuinene, after the introduction of a fresh body of colonists, had a revolution. The Syracusans, after the expulsion of their tyrants, having admitted strangers and mercenaries to the rights of citizenship, quarreled and came to blows, and on and on. In other words, he is a scientist. He's the first scientist, really, unlike Plato, who was just a philosopher. And he looked in the world and saw what he saw. And he said, hey, this is worrisome. Don't let people in unless they have a common spirit. And so I'm not against Muslims coming here, as long as they adopt, they get assimilated into our ideas.
It's a valid point, but again, if you look at the U.S., right, I mean, as much as people these days are calling for foreigners to come in and kind of assimilate, let's not forget that segregation was officially sanctioned in this country until the mid-1960s, right? We had laws in place effectively So, as much as we like to talk about, oh, in our country, when you come in, the history is not consistent with this self-perception, right? So, you know, just as we've made mistakes and we're trying to rectify them, certainly, you know, coming from the outside, seeking to assimilate, it does take time. I mean, it's always a little challenging to kind of move into a new environment, and kind of get the lay of the land and so first generation always struggles, but eventually I'm confident that the people from Latin America, from the Islamic world who come to the U.S. next week, within difficult as the adjustment might be, within a generation or two, will be as American looking as you are, technically first generation French Canadian. I'm not there quite yet. There's something you said earlier, Greg, that I think is very interesting. You know, when you quoted Lewis, you talk about true Islam. That's the problem, I think. People assume that there's a true interpretation of religion. The problem is everybody thinks their own interpretation is the true one, right? We need to recognize that organized religion is just that, organized religion. You know, after 9/11, President Bush came out saying that, well, this wasn't real Islam, this wasn't true Islam, that Islam is a religion of peace. That's also incorrect. It's just a religion, right? You can make it whatever you want it to be. It's like Christians saying, well, Buddhism is the world's most peaceful religion. No, absolutely not. Again, you know, you find conflict fueled by Buddhism. There's no, religions don't exist in absolute form. It's all relative. It's how it's all how we choose to interpret them. And I think that's the root of the problem, is that religions allow for all kinds of interpretations, ridiculously open and liberal and peaceful ones, and at the other extreme, ridiculously rigid and violent and mean ones. But the problem is, it's not like, you know, God will appear and tell us, actually, you know, the real one is French Canadian Catholicism, right? We don't, so we have to recognize the relativity of what we believe in, and allow for the possibility that we're wrong, which unfortunately the true believer cannot allow himself or herself to do.
Let me interrupt here for a second, though. You just made another violation of the theory of logical types, Bertrand Russell. You said, I'm sure that the coming across the southern border, those Catholics and the Muslims that are all going to become Americans and so forth. Yeah, again, I think that's true for anybody. The only religion in the world, the only one, as part of its creed, as part of the Quran, if you read it, that calls for constant warfare until it's conquered the world, is Islam. It's separate. That's why if you look around the world at all the fights that are going on, whether it's in India or Afghanistan or wherever it is, Central African Republic, it's always Islam that's there as the source of it, because some jihadists, now it's a minority, I agree, but even if it's 1%, let's say it's 1% of 1.3 billion, that's 13 million. That means 13 million jihadists are running around the world with that interpretation, and they're going to be a problem. Now, this Sadiq Khan is ridiculous. I heard him this morning on television. He said, well, this terrorism is just there. You just sort of have to expect that in urban society. No, you don't have to expect that.
Yeah, he said that last year, but it was tweeted by Trump's son. That's something he said. He said last year. But no, but you know, this whole idea, right? I mean, look at Christianity. I mean, any religious text has something akin to jihad, or in Christianity, it's the idea of just war, right? Of just struggle, and depending on the time and the circumstances, religious authorities will use that to their benefit. Blame the Catholics again.
But not Jesus. You see, Jesus didn't say just war, go out and kill the enemy.
No, but the way we construe the Old Testament, we construe the New Testament.
That's the Jews, but
you know what I mean, right? Christians, Muslims, Jews, Buddhists have within their scriptures justifications to go to war, to do horrible things, and have actually used their scriptures to those very ends.
Well, the Jews only to get the Holy Land. That was their, you can go out and kill everybody in Jericho to get to the Holy Land. That was the path that they made with God. Christians, nowhere in scripture does Jesus ever give anything but turn the other cheek, right? He's a very peaceful guy. He's love.
Well, assuming that, see, as I understand it, I don't remember much from Catholic school, but as I understand it, being Christian implies both the Old and the New Testament. And I remember as a kid reading the Old Testament and being terrified because it's such a violent book. But even the idea of the other cheek, I mean, technically, if we really kind of live closely by the terms of the New Testament, I think we'd all be communists. Mm-hmm. But the people who consider themselves most Christian abhor that kind of thinking, that's kind of egalitarian thinking.
You scored a lot of points here. We're running out of time.